Now, on our last half of our class here, on class number five, I want to get ahead here and then I'll go back. Let me do this. Let's start, because I didn't give the number of the test here on the numbers. Let me start out here. Okay. Question number one, and I forgot to give you your memory verse, is 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12. That's your memory verse. Love thinking not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is going to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you. Okay? 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Question 2. In Genesis 1:2, the earth was without form and void. The word was should be translated how? The answer is became. Question number 3. What scripture tells us the original creation was not created without form and void, but contrarywise? Isaiah. The answer is Isaiah chapter 45, verse 18. Question number 4. After God expelled Satan and his followers from the original creation, in what condition did it then exist? 3 things. Number 1, total darkness. Number 2, completely covered with water. And number 3, ice covered. There was no... that's just 3 answers. Okay, question 5. The word created is a Hebrew bara, and it means the instant creation of something that had no previous existence. Question number 6. The word made in the Hebrew is asha, A-S-A-H, and basically means to remodel. That's the answer for it. Okay? Question number 7. Why is the second day the only day that God did not say it was good? The answer is because it is Satan and his demons' domain. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, he is the prince of the power of the air. That's where he resides today, isn't it? Gets awful close to earth there a lot of times, doesn't he, huh? In fact, I think he sleeps down here. Okay. Question number 8. What was man's diet in the first dispensation? Answer, vegetarian. Now the reason we say that, and we'll see that as you get going on, when it comes to getting all these animals, there was no fear of man because they just came. God brought them. They're just not scared of man because never ate them. Question number 9. What differs in mankind from animals? It's very interesting. The answer is, the human spirit, seed of our intelligence. Now, if you want to, and we're going to take a minute here and stop right here on question 9, all right? Because I want you to get this so that you have an answer for this. Go with me over to the book of Job in chapter 32 and verse 8, okay? Job chapter 32 here in verse 8. Okie doke. It's very easy to remember, because then you're going to Psalms chapter 38. So it's very easy to remember these two here that bring it together, all right? Okay, Job chapter 32, notice here in verse 8. But there is a spirit in man, and the inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding. A spirit in man that gives them understanding. Hold your place. Go with me over here too. Psalms chapter 32, verse 9. Psalms chapter 32, verse 9, very easy to remember. Psalms 32 and verse 9, it's the understanding, which is the spirit, you see, okay? Psalms 32 in verse 9, here's what it says. Be you not as the horse or as the mule, which hath no understanding. So if they have no understanding, then they don't have the spirit. Do they have a soul? Yes, animals have a soul. What do you mean soul? Isn't the soul the seat of your emotions and your appetites? Charlie and Jesse, or Jezebel, my two cats, they have a soul. And they have different personalities. They don't have any understanding about anything. They do things by habit. That's what they do. They do things by habit and so forth. But they don't have the spirit in them that man has. They can't drive a car. You know, they can't do this, they can't do that, they can't write, they can't talk, they can't do these things, they can't do it. Okay? Now, let's look over here, and another thing that if you want to put down here, let me see where I got this at. I put that down. To do that. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. Let's go over there. We'll get that, because that'll give us a little bit about the spirit here. And animals don't have a spirit. That's the seat of your intelligence. They do things by habit. They do it by instinct. But as far as having a spirit like man, where they can invent anything, they can do anything, they can talk, they can't do that. That's the difference. Be not as a horse and a mule, which hath no understanding. Okay? Let's go over here to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we'll look here in verse 10, all right? But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. And what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? That's your human spirit. Even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. That's the Holy Spirit. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, you say, but that is what the world teaches through the human spirit. You see a lot of that wherever you go, don't you? Don't you see the philosophy of the world through the human spirit? The reasoning of the world, there is no God, the atheists, agnostics, and so forth. And now we got going around with all, we're going to prove the Bible. We're going to prove the Bible by science. The only trouble is science falsely so-called. We're using science as a gimmick to rake off money and tell us that the earth is only 6,000 years old. That's the biggest gimmick ever was. Nobody even thought about that till Ellen G. White, founder of Seventh-day Adventists, came up with it. She's one of the first that we know of that came up with the idea of a young earth. Then it was passed on, and now we got these so-called scientists running all over the place with footprints of these great big dinosaurs. Isn't it something? One man sold his dinosaur, the one that he had made a replica out of, for I don't know how many millions of dollars down in Texas. But all of this stuff going on. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. That's the Holy Spirit through the Bible. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God. God breathed. Which things also we speak not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but with the Holy Ghost, which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. A natural man, which has the natural spirit, but he's a natural man, receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they're spiritually discerned, and so forth. But anyway, what we want to show you, the difference between animals and between man is the Spirit, which is the seat of man's intelligence. The heart is the seat of his conscience. The soul is the seat of his emotions and his appetites. That's not going to be on your test, but it's just good for you to know that, you know, and to see that. Okay. Now, let's go on down here and get the rest of what we're going to have. Let's go to number 10. Okay, number 9 is, what differs in mankind from animals? The human spirit, seed of our intelligence. Animals don't have that. They go by instinct, they go by habit. Question number 10. Cain was a religious man and even believed in God, even though his old nature enticed him to kill his brother. True or false? Good, no trick. Innocence. Innocent, I'm innocent. Okay. That's an easy one. Now we come to Genesis chapter 3, verse 22. Let's go back here to Genesis chapter 3, verse 22, which we'll quote on your test here. All right? Genesis 3 here in verse 22. The Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us to know good or evil. The question is, define us. Who is us? That's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Same as God in Genesis chapter 1. Elohim, Him, E-L-O-H-I-M. The I am is the Hebrew, which is the plural, three or more. Us. Here we have the Trinity right here. Okay? How could God know good and evil before Adam and Eve had sinned? You see? And he did. 12. Huh? Yeah, this is number, no. Let's see here. What do we got here? 22. Let me see here. No. I think I have two questions out of 22. I do. When the Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us. Okay, that is number one under number 11. Question 11 has two parts. Define us. Well, you know that. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's a gift to God. And Max.
What's the first part of this question?
Okay, the first. We quote, it's going to be quoted on your test, this verse in Genesis 3:22. It's going to be quoted. Then there's two questions about this verse. Okay. The first question is, define us. Let me read the verse. And the Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us. So the question is, define us. That's God speaking. And the answer is, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, plural pronoun. The second question under question 11 about that verse is, to know good and evil, and now let us put forth his hand and also take of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Okay, the Lord God said, now, to know good and evil. Well, how did they know? How did God know good and evil? And the question is, how could God know good and evil before Adam and Eve had sinned? That's the second question under question 11. Question 11 contains two questions within it. The answer is, how did God know good and evil before Adam and Eve had sinned? Very simply, the sin and rebellion of Satan and his angels on the original creation. On there. Okay, question number 12. How do we know from Genesis 1:11 that the original creation had fruit trees, grass, herbs, and fit to eat? The answer is, it was created with the seed in it. Created with the seed in it. Question number 12. Question number 12. Or 13, I'm sorry. Yeah. Death is a first mentioned principle, which principle carries all through the Bible. Death basically means what? The answer is separation. Now, this is concerning death. Next question, but it's not numbered 14, it's just numbered 1 under question 13. Describe spiritual death. That's the question. The answer is separation from God for all eternity. Number 2 under question 13, describe physical death. Separation of soul and spirit from the body. In Galatians, or in James 2:26, the spirit, the body without the spirit is dead. Okay, question 14 now. When Satan deceived Eve, it was through three avenues of enticement. He was so successful that he has employed it ever since on all humanity. What are these three? Number 1, lust of the eyes. Number 2, lust of the flesh. Number 3, the pride of life. And the reference to that is 1 John chapter 2 in verse 16. But the only thing you need is lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Those three answers. Then, in Genesis chapter 3, in verse 15, let me get that one here. Genesis 3:15. I think we gave that out to you last week, didn't we? A little slip on Genesis chapter 3, verse 15? Okay. Okie doke. Which says this, and I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So the question is, in question 15, we'll quote that verse, define enmity. The answer is warfare. Define thy seed. Answer, Satan and his followers. Define her seed. The answer is Jesus Christ. Define it shall bruise thy head. The answer is the end of Satan cast into the lake of fire forever. And a verse, well, you don't have to have the verse, but it is Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. But his head is not bruised yet, because we find out in Romans chapter 16, verse 20, when Paul wrote to those in Rome, he said that he shall bruise the head of Satan shortly. So the head stroke has not been given to Satan, although the heel is being bruised by stepping on him every time he tries to rise up and interfere with God's will on the earth. You see, now, with that in mind, I want to take you one place. This is not going to be on your test, but it's something you need to know. And this will give you an answer, because this gets a little tricky sometimes. When we come over here, and we find out here that Eve ate first, we find out also that Adam was not deceived. Go over here with me to Timothy, if you'll do this, all right? In the Bible here. Over here to Timothy, all right? And we look here in 1 Timothy here in chapter 2. And then we're going to show you why that Adam purposely took of the fruit. And there was a reason for it, which only would have kept the human race going without God creating someone else, you see. Okay, let's notice what it says. Look down here in verse 13. For Adam was first formed, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression. So if Adam was not deceived, he wasn't tricked, he wasn't deceived, he knew exactly what he was doing, he knew he shouldn't eat of it, but he purposely did it. Why did he do it and just say, no, Eve, I'm not partaking of that? Well, there's a little more involved than what just meets the surface. Notice in verse up here, in the next verse here, in verse 15. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing. Actually, the word is dia, in, and it means through childbearing, if, on a condition, if they continue in faith and charity and holiness and sobriety. In other words, now, number one, there was a condition whether the human race goes on. Adam was not deceived. Okay, here's the situation you have. I don't know if you ever thought about this or not. Adam hadn't sinned, so he couldn't die. He had no nature that was going to die. He could have went ahead and ate of the tree of life and lived on forever. Eve had sinned, and when she sinned, she had the old nature, did she not? Isn't that right? She had an old nature. Adam did not have an old nature. He had not sinned. There is no way that Adam could have had conception with Eve. What kind of monstrosity of a child would that have produced? Would it produce a child that could never die, or would it produce a child with the old nature? What would it do? I mean, what kind of child would you have? In order for the human race to continue, Adam had to be on the same level physically, however you want to put it, to where they could have conception, so the child born would have the right nature. A child could not be born with a nature that couldn't die and a nature that had to die. What kind of child would that be? How could you have that? You couldn't have humanity going on with a situation like that. So Adam wasn't deceived. Either one or two things. There could be no conception with Eve, because God would not going to allow that to happen. He either had to partake and have a sin nature, and God would provide the sacrifice for both of them to continue the human race, or it would stop right there. So, purposely, he wasn't deceived, knew exactly what he was doing, and partook of that so he could be on the same spiritual level with an old nature as what his wife would be, but trusting God that there would be the blood sacrifice that would clothe them with the skins of the animals, and therefore the human race could continue, and that blood would cleanse every person from after the offspring of Adam and Eve. And the proof here, now when you look this up a little bit here, notwithstanding she shall be saved through childbearing, if they continue, means abide, in faith and charity. Now the word charity there is agape, and even the what we say in the Greek agape, and holiness, and sobriety. That means sound judgment. That was proof, because the children that were born was Cain and Abel, isn't that right? And wasn't Abel the one that brought the blood sacrifice? Of course. So they taught the children, you got to bring the right sacrifice, the blood sacrifice. Cain rebelled. He brought the fruit of his land, what he grew, to present how beautiful this was, and it probably was. And God just took it up and put it back at his front door and said, sin lieth at your door. I'm not accepting this whatsoever, you see. And then he told Cain, he said, I'm going to set a mark upon you. You killed Abel. And I'll tell you what, do you have anything today that is similar like that? Anything like that today? Well, you take religion. It hates you. Over in Ireland, or Ireland, between the Protestants and the Catholics, good night. All they do is kill each other. You hear about that, right? Listen up. They hate each other. And then it'll settle down for a while. And then it'll rise up again. You take in America. Good night. I don't... when you're saved, and you especially, if you get somebody saved out of a family, it's just like the Jews. I remember one fellow, a Jewish fellow, I have a book written by him. And he got saved. First thing that his grandmother did was take him down to the bank and said, I'll give you, it was either an enormous amount of money if you'll deny Jesus Christ right now. Hoff was his last name. He's a good friend of Dr. Cameron's. And anyway, he would not do that. He did not deny Christ, and he went on to be a missionary and so forth with Jewish people. But you got people that just hate Christianity, but they love the religion. Is it any different with Cain? Not a bit. Not one bit. Humanity hasn't changed. So the thing I wanted you to know was this. Why that Adam was not deceived is the fact that when he partook of the fruit, he knew that the only way that the humanity could continue on was if he was on the same spiritual level as what Eve was, and that was a sinner. You cannot produce a baby through reproduction from a body that would not die because Adam had not sinned. And with a woman that did sin and had an old nature, what kind of nature would it have had? It was an impossibility. Would it die? Would it not die? Would half of it die? The other half live? It was just a monstrosity. You see, that's the only thing that I wanted you to know on that, which helps explain this verse here in 1 Timothy. You see, that's not going to be on your test, but we're in the first dispensation here, and then we're going to be ready here to start on the second dispensation. So that's the end of the test here. It's on question 15, which has four parts to it. Define enmity as warfare. Answer. Define thy seed. The answer is Satan and his followers. Define her seed. That's Jesus Christ. And define it shall bruise thy head. And that is the end of Satan cast into the lake of fire forever. And the verse, of course, Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, you don't have to have that at all. Is he there now? Of course not. Because Romans chapter 16, verse 20 said, he shall bruise his head shortly. Thus far, it hasn't happened. He stepped on him many times. He stopped him many times. But the death wound is to the head. You can patch a leg. You can patch an arm and one thing or another. But when the head gets crushed, you're done. And that's what he uses for Satan here. Okay. Now, the next thing we start on here, in fact, I'll give this to you ahead of time here. For the test after that, I'll at least give you a memory verse here, and then we're going into the second dispensation, which is the dispensation of conscience. Innocence is the first dispensation. Second one is conscience. And that's what we'll go on. That begins with Genesis chapter 4 to Genesis chapter 8. And that'll be the second dispensation. That'll be a very interesting one. As we get here, what about your conscience? You are to do good and avoid evil. There, your conscience was to be your guide. Your conscience will always tell you to do good, but it will not tell you what is good. That's sort of interesting, isn't it? It'll always tell you to do good, but it won't always tell you what is good. That's interesting. Now we're going to tie that in with Hebrews, where the Word of God is quick, powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit. And you'll be a little surprised what it means, dividing of the soul and the spirit. That's going to be interesting. And you experience it all the time. You mean? So it'd be interesting when you get into that. But right there, I think our time is, how's our time doing?
Okay, about 5 minutes.
About 5 minutes. Okay, I think we can stop there, and we'll start on Next week, we'll start on the second dispensation, which will be a dispensation of conscience. Okay, we've had innocence expelled out of the garden. Conscience, every dispensation, begins with a covenant and ends with a judgment. So we'll stop there. And let's have a word of prayer. And let's see, Megan, would you have we called on you before? Yeah. Okay, would you dismiss us tonight, if you will? Thank you. Amen. Thank you.